Alafia and welcome. This is Nkechi Taifa, civil and human rights attorney, scholar activist, freedom fighter, and bestseller author. This is Human Rights and Justice, my thought-provoking talk show featuring kick-ass commentary and stimulating guests. We discuss domestic and global themes, highlighting political, economic, and social rights. Get up and stand up with me, Nkechi Taifa, for Human Rights and Justice.
We declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the right of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary.
Yes, we're going to bring it into existence by any means necessary. This is attorney Nkechi Taifa, host of WPFW's Human Rights and Justice. This program is part of Radio Free Palestine, an annual 24-hour marathon airing on Nakba Day, May 15th, with participation from community and progressive radio stations and producers across five continents. I am so thrilled and honored to have as my guest today none other than a close colleague of mine for just quite a number of years. We're talking about Jamil Dakwar, who is an attorney, a human rights lawyer, an adjunct professor at NYU. He is also the director of the American Civil Liberties Union's Human Rights Program. But he is not speaking in that capacity. He is only speaking in his personal capacity. As we talk today about the Palestinian solidarity movement and a right to self-determination for Palestine, and in light of the unfolding, unrelenting genocide in Gaza. Welcome, my brother Jamil. How are you?
Thank you. I'm doing well. Thank you for having me on your show. I'm so thrilled to join you, Nkechi. I'm a big fan of your amazing work and leadership over the years. So thank you for having me on.
It is indeed my pleasure, my brother. So, you know, can you just talk to us a little bit more about yourself? Talk to us about where you grew up, you know, what your experience was as growing up as a Palestinian in Israel. I know you probably shared this many times before. Our WPFW Pacifica audience, share with us about you.
Yeah, well, I think I have a little bit of an unusual background because not only that I'm a Palestinian living now and a citizen of the United States, an American citizen since 2019, actually, but I also, I am a citizen of the State of Israel. I was born and raised in Haifa, which is in the north, portal city, beautiful portal city in the north of Israel, which is, you know, in historic Palestine. My upbringing was there. I went to local schools, actually local church-run schools, because the public school system was non-existent for Palestinian citizens. We had and then we can talk a little more about that in the show. But it was really the only way that Palestinians, particularly who are living inside Israel, could get really good education. They had to go to those church-run schools that are missionary schools that were created like hundreds of years ago, and they were serving the Palestinian community and the Arab community, both Palestinian Christian Muslims and Druze, actually, and teaching and education was the was in Arabic as my first language. My mother tongue language is Arabic. So I went to high school, elementary school, high school in those schools, and then graduated and went to Tel Aviv University Law School, where I pursued my law degree. You know, in Israel, again, there is no Arab university in Israel. There's certainly no law school in Israel. There are only the main Israeli universities are the only place for Palestinians could go, with the exception of few colleges, teacher colleges, but they are not really offering all the different kinds of programs that you want to pursue as a college student. And so I went to Tel Aviv University Law School. I've been involved and active since high school in political and social issues in my high school, but I got more and more involved in what's going on since I went to college in the, that was in, or law school in the early 1990s.
Let me just ask, to piggyback off of what you said when you went to Tel Aviv University, did you experience any disconnect or anything like that being a Palestinian in an Israeli university? I mean, I went to a predominantly white law school myself, GW. Okay, maybe we touch on GW a little later dealing with the student protests. But I'm just curious, as a Palestinian in the early 90s, I think you're saying I'm going to Tel Aviv University. Talk to us a little bit more about.
Yeah, so it was very alienating. You know, Tel Aviv was created years ago, before Israel was even established as a colony, in outside the Palestinian city of Jaffa. So, and it became a much bigger city after Israel was created in 1948. So the area where Tel Aviv University exists right now is actually the area that sits partly on a ruined and destroyed village, Palestinian village that was destroyed in 1948, called Sheikh Mohannes. And that the residents and the Palestinian residents of this village were forced out of that land and they were never allowed to come back. So we've learned about this history. So going there and seeing the high rise buildings, you know, of Tel Aviv, but particularly in that very wealthy area north of Tel Aviv and Ramat Aviv Gimel. First thing that I encountered was actually getting decent housing. It was I couldn't get access to school housing, university housing. I had to go to off campus, and it was really tough to get. And usually the conversation would go like this: tell me more about yourself. And then when I mentioned, they would see me, they would think that I'm maybe Jewish Israeli because of my lighter skin. And then when they hear my name and they said, what's the origin of your name? And what's your, and then maybe because as a first year law student, my Hebrew was not great at the time. I had a little accent, obviously, and wasn't ashamed of that. But immediately they realized that they are dealing with an Arab Palestinian. A lot of landlords rejected. And the only way that I was able with other Palestinian students get an apartment was that we had to deposit something like $3,000 on cash, available cash on deposit, which is a lot of money for that period of time. I remember we had to ask family members to give us all the savings and put them on the side. And that was available cash just in case, you know, we do something, ruin the apartment or do something. And that was one of the ways that they have discriminated against applicants who were Palestinian and Arabs by, instead of saying, well, many others found different pretexts, but that was my experience. And just in general, the alienation of, like, you are living in a place where most people don't speak your language. And if you spoke your language, you had been looked at as someone who was threatening. You know, Arabic is taught very, very in a limited way in Jewish Israeli schools. In fact, it's not a mandatory. There's no mandatory teaching in Arabic in Israeli Jewish schools. But I had to study Hebrew. I studied, of course, English and Arabic. And then because I went to these church schools, I also studied Italian and French until elementary school. So, and I go there and I see, like, we are really a tiny minority. We are a few hundreds, about 600, 700 students in a gigantic university that had, I think, roughly of, at the time, 10,000 or 15,000 students. So we're really a tiny minority. And we had to organize because the student association or council would not accept to integrate a lot of programming for Palestinian students that we wanted to preserve our culture, our identity as Palestinians, and our activism, political activism, particularly in that time when Israel was switching from was the end of the first intifada, the beginning of so-called peace process, and there was this joyful atmosphere, environment that finally there is a peace going to happen. But we knew as students, activists, that was not really there was something not right about this process. We of course didn't know all the details, but we did read and we did get news. I remember reading the article that was published by Edward Said, professor at Columbia at the time, who criticized the Oslo Accords as one that betrays the fundamental rights of the Palestinian people. And on the very basic level, that these Oslo Accords in 1993 that were signed between Israel and the Palestinian Liberation Organization, after secret talks that were held bypassing the talks and held in Oslo, Norway, had only recognized the PLO as legitimate representative of the Palestinian people, not the right to self-determination of the Palestinian people. On the other hand, the PLO had to recognize the Israel right to exist in peace and security, etc. And so there was an imbalance. And we clearly knew that there was something not right. And we also felt that that was marginalizing our call for equality within the state of Israel. As Palestinian citizens, there have been years and decades of systemic racism, structural discrimination against us, land confiscation, housing discrimination, budget allocation inequities in the allocation of budgets, et cetera, et cetera. And we knew that this process was not intended to give us the hope that we will finally be equal citizens. So we had to look inward. And I was part of a movement, student movement. We ended up creating a student movement called Jofra with other colleagues of mine that ended up supporting also a national party calling for equality and for the state of Israel to become a full democracy, state for all its citizens, something that has not been recognized as an important part of the struggle for equality, because Israel claimed that it was a Jewish state and a democratic state. And for us, it was a contradiction. We thought that you can't really be full democracy if you're only going to be a state that we're going to give privileges and you're going to protect the rights of those who are belonging to a particular religion. And so we had that struggle from the very, very early on. So my experience has been really interesting because I also happen to have that background of knowing about the history of Palestine. But most students would not be taught about their history as Palestinians in elementary schools, in high school, particularly because of censorship, because of the control of security services in the Shabak, the Shirut Bitachon Klali, which is the Israel's like a secret service that in charge of internal security was controlling the education system during the time that I was raised in Haifa and later on. So there was a lot of that control and that, yes, separating the education system in order to control what the Palestinian Arab citizen can teach and can learn and deny them the ability to be able to be part of the Palestinian people, including in West Bank and Gaza.
So, you know, Jamil, I see a whole lot of similarities between what you talked about in terms of growing up in Palestine and my growing up here in the United States. I grew up during the 50s and 60s in the United States, and we didn't learn anything about Black history or anything along those lines. It was segregation, there was redlining, all those things that were going on. And even when you were talking about the language situation, it reminded me of Soweto in South Africa, where the Black South Africans were forced to learn in Afrikaans, the language of the white settler colonists, and they wanted their own language. So I see so many similarities. So you talked a little bit about your experience growing up as a Palestinian in Israel. Well, what does it feel like to be a Palestinian right here in America today?
Right. So it is really a very difficult time for the Palestinian people, particularly for Palestinians in Gaza, as they are experiencing, as you said, unrelenting and genocide unfolding as we speak. And we know now today the reports about Israel invading and crushing and bombing Rafah and other parts, and even other parts that it said that it had, defeated the resistance there and Hamas from those areas. Now we've seen that this is continuing. So, of course, for Palestinians who live in the United States, we are connected to what's happening by family ties, by knowing this is an ongoing assault on our rights and existence from the very beginning of the creation, not only just the state of Israel, but the creation of really of the Zionist project that really claimed that we did not exist. The whole idea, the whole ideology of the Zionist movement has been that we are the Zionist movement is going to create to find a land for people without land. In other words, this is will be a movement for finding people without land for land without people. That Palestine was not really inhabited. It was not had this history of people thriving even under the British mandate and control between 1922 and 1947-48. And the Palestinians were part of just like other peoples in the Middle East. They had, some of them were farmers and doing mostly farming and agriculture, but many of them are also were living in major thriving cities like Jaffa, like my home city, Haifa, like Lydd and Rumli. Jerusalem was a very thriving city that had both economy and culture and art and you name it, right? And that all stopped, and that all destroyed with the war of 1948, with the Nakba, which we call the catastrophe, the Palestinian catastrophe. The word in Arabic is Nakba, and that is something that Palestinians everywhere feel that continues to this day. In essentially, there's no disconnect between what happened pre-1948 and during the war of 1948 and what is happening to the Palestinians now. So Palestinians in America feeling the heart, the very, very strong feelings of inability to be able to help and support their people and brothers and sisters in the way of being able to be safe. And to be protected and to receive the humanitarian support and aid, just like any other nation that is under assault. And unfortunately, being in the United States, it is compounded by the fact that the United States government itself is launching or assisting the Israeli government and complicit in Israeli government attacks on the Gaza Strip and complicit in genocide. Now, there is disagreement about whether that is a genocide or not. I think that people will look back in history and will see that they were wrong. We know that the International Court of Justice, and we can talk more about it, has concluded earlier this year that there is a plausible case that genocide is taking place. The Biden administration has been sued by the Center for Constitutional Rights for complicity and in failure to prevent acts of genocide. And this case is still pending. And there's an argument in early June before the Ninth Circuit. There is a documentation and analysis by genocide scholars and historians that have said that this is a genocide. We know what United Nations experts have said, that this is a genocide that needs to be prevented, including the UN Special Rapporteur on Palestine herself, who did a report just the last month on genocide. And so
I'm just going to interrupt you for a moment. I just must, because I am Nkechi Taifa, and I have studied the International Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide. And I just, for the life of me, don't understand why there's so much controversy as to what is genocide and what is not. When I looked at the definition, and even in the United States, it was ratified by the United States Senate, and it is the only UN treaty and US law that is actionable without implementing legislation, because it already came with implementing legislation. That definitely, I'm just going to repeat it because I've said it again on this show.
Absolutely.
Killing members
Absolutely.
Of the group.
I mean, well, we have it also.
Bodily or mental harm to members of the group, deliberately inflicting upon the group conditions of life calculated to bring about their destruction in whole or in part, taking measures to prevent births within the group, forcibly transferring children from one group to another. And it said that genocide is not the only actionable act. Conspiracy to commit genocide, directing public incitement to commit genocide, attempt to commit genocide, and complicity. And so I don't understand. It's inviting. Why is there so much controversy and debate over the very obvious thing that is going on right there by the Israelis in Gaza, whether it is or is not a genocide?
Well, I think the reason for that is because it is seen as, if you decided, if you really looked at the fact and decided, determined that genocide is in fact taking place, there are legal responsibilities first. There are political consequences internationally, what that means, particularly with regard to governments and countries that respect international law, unlike the United States that cherry picks what to take of international law. There are many countries that are actually taking a principled position, and we've seen countries that are cutting ties with the state of Israel because of what's happening in Gaza, like Colombia, like even South Africa took a very strong position of calling back their ambassador. Other countries doing similar acts of and saying, look, this is not something that we can agree with. And we have, in fact, obligations as members of or signatories to the genocide conventions to take actions to prevent and to criminalize and to punish those who are inciting to genocide. And that was the purpose of that action that South Africa took. So I think in the United States, it's always been a difficult political sensitivities around the use of the word genocide. It started with genocide against the indigenous peoples in the United States. It goes through the resistance to use of genocide against Black people in the United States. And that's, as you know, and you've spoken and you've written about this, that was the reason why the United States have not ratified the Genocide Convention until 1988. Right. And not only that, it has also resisted the ratification of other international human rights treaties and making them enforceable in a United States domestic courts or having other important domestic implications because of the fact that there was a resistance from early on to Jim Crow and to lynching of Black people and to mass killings that happened over decades and centuries. So, so there is always been an exceptions to when and how the genocide will be utilized and used. And I unfortunately, in this case, this is not just about the United States making the decision related to a conflict that's happening overseas that it has no control over. It actually has direct responsibility because of the way that Israel has been using United States weapons, especially offensive weapons, unlike other reporting and the State Department report that just came out yesterday, suggesting that, well, we don't know whether our weapons have been used. But this president himself said on CNN earlier last week that it was, they were used. So they were trying to muddy the water in terms of like, what are the legal obligations? The international law is very clear. As you stated, Genocide Convention defined genocide as the intent to destroy a national or racial, ethnic, or religious group in whole or in part, right? And those acts that constitute genocide could include what we're seeing in Gaza, the killing of members of the group, the Palestinian people, causing serious mental or physical harm to members of the group, imposing conditions that are intended to bring about the physical destruction of the group. If that is not genocide, what is? And so I think that it is really a part of the, unfortunately, the politics of Israel in the United States. And there is a lobby in the United States that is pushing against any attempt to hold Israel accountable. We know that it goes not just with the ICJ and the Genocide Convention. It is related to holding Israel accountable to lesser crimes that have been committed over the decades. War crimes, crimes against humanity, and most recently, in particular, crimes against humanity of apartheid. As Amnesty, Human Rights Watch, Palestinian and Israeli organizations, and even a UN, some UN experts have said that Israel is committing the crime of apartheid in the way that's been treating Palestinians historically. So there is really a double standard and hypocrisy. And in fact, more than that, it is complicity. And that is where I think for us, for Palestinians who live in the United States, back to your question about how do we feel that our government is betraying its own commitments. It's betraying its communities that it said that it is going to embrace them, care for their safety, for their families. But we know that over the years that was not true. Palestinian journalist Shireen Akhli, we today today or yesterday, we had 2 years of since she was killed by snipers in Jenin, covering Israeli military operations in Jenin, and she is a Palestinian-American citizen, and not a single person has been held accountable, even though Secretary Blinken promised, and there was an FBI, some sort of FBI investigation into the killing. So we know that there's always been a gap between what the United States said and what it does when it comes to closest allies. And in this case, Israel is considered as one that is not protecting only its own interests, but it's also in protecting United States interests. And that's a really important point, where most people think, oh, that U.S. is doing that for the sake of just supporting Israel. Yes, there is some sort of historical guilt that has that the United States have failed to protect Jewish communities and Jewish people in Europe during World War II and preventing the Holocaust. And that over the years have translated into taking better action, better protection against anti-Semitism, and then the connection has been made that, well, if you really committed to defending people from anti-Semitism, it shouldn't just be about anti-Semitism in the United States. It had to be supporting Israel as part of the formula that any criticism of Israel, any attack on Israel's legitimacy as a Jewish state that denies equality to non-Jewish people is anti-Semitic. And this is another part of what we feel in the United States, is that even speaking about Palestinian rights in the United States, and me personally been attacked, smeared, and even almost prevented from giving a talk at Indiana University a few years ago, because I called for using boycott as a method, as a peaceful method, to protest what Israel is doing. And they use that. If you're calling for boycott, you would be considered anti-Semitic, because you're singling out Israel for this kind of treatment. You are calling Israel that it is a state that has used racist laws, which if even Israeli Jewish scholars and organizations came to the conclusion that there is serious violations of international human rights, particularly the commission of the crime of apartheid since Israel's founding.
You are listening to a 24-hour special on Nakba Day, produced internationally by Radio Free Palestine, with the English stream produced by WPFW. Okay, so let me go to another question right now. So while Jewish Israelis will be celebrating Israel's Independence Day this week, Palestinians will be commemorating their Nakba, as you said, great catastrophe of 1948. Can you explain the conflicting narrative? And does this occasion have a special meaning to you and the Palestinian people this year, especially when the genocide is ongoing in Gaza?
Yes, I mean, this is going to be a very difficult week for Palestinian people, because as I said, the Nakba is a traumatic event that is an ongoing one. It has never stopped. It never, even though the majority of the Palestinian people were uprooted, forced to leave, or denied return since the war of 1947-48. And since Israel's existence, it denied the right of Palestinians to return to their homeland. And so the majority of the Palestinian people became refugees in neighboring Arab countries. To this day, you have refugee camps all over Lebanon and Jordan and Syria, and few have also became refugees in Egypt. And so the Nakba, that event that created Israel, which Israelis and Jewish Israelis celebrate as their Independence Day, it is for us the day that has caused the destruction of our homeland, the destruction of over 400 Palestinian towns and villages, including major communities, thriving communities in cities like Jaffa, Lod, Ramle, and Haifa. It resembles the mass displacement and killing, but also the depriving Palestinians of ability to not only live in their homeland, but also to connect and to preserve their culture, to preserve their history, to preserve their ability to bring their existence and to share it with their new generation. So the Nakba is an ongoing and traumatic event for us. And what's happening in Gaza, in fact, since the very beginning of the war, we have warned that what we're seeing is a continuation of the Nakba, because the Palestinians who are living in Gaza are actually 75% or more are descendants of refugees who became refugees in 1948, and some of them also became refugees or internally displaced people during the 1967 war, when Israel expanded its control over Palestinians from 80% of historic Palestine to 100% of historic Palestine by occupying the West Bank and Gaza. So the people who live in Gaza have already gone through the Nakba. They have already been displaced. They can see, and they are 5 or 7 miles away from their original hometowns and villages, which were completely destroyed. And over those towns and villages, Israel created settlements that were intended to set facts on the ground that there is no return. This is not a homeland for the Palestinian people. You stay out of Palestine. This is new entity that is called Israel. And that is actually, by the way, it's also a violation of UN partition plan from 1947. That plan, which rejected by the Palestinian leadership and generally Palestinian people, because they thought was unfair. It was taking major parts of their homeland, dividing it, and giving it to a movement or members of the community that were coming and establishing settlements and considered themselves as colonizers. I mean, it's not that the Palestinians are defining the Zionist movement as a settler colonial movement. It was defined by the founders, by organizations that were created and called and used the word settler organizations or movement, mm-hmm. etc. So, but the one thing that obviously makes it very different than many other settler colonial situations is that many of the people who had come to Israel since 1948, since its creation, some of them were able to come before 48, before the war, were the victims of the Holocaust. They were the ones who were in themselves persecuted and subject to mass slaughter and genocide in Europe. It has nothing to do with Palestinians or Arab nations. It was a German Nazi plan to exterminate Jewish people and cause this horror, and led to the fact that many of the Jewish people felt no place to go. In fact, there were many countries that would not take Jewish refugees. The only place that could go was the state of Israel, including the United States, that had some of your viewers, you would remember the case of the St. Louis, which is the ship that was carrying Jewish refugees and came to rejected mm-hmm. from reaching the shores of the United States,
yeah.
and was rejected. And many of those people have been survivors of, and have been returned to Europe where they had been massacred. So mm-hmm. there is a very difficult a narrative here that it's mm-hmm. not easy to understand if you're just going to go along with just, you know, super, you know, very, very much on the surface, or without digging deep into what's happened. So for many Jewish Israelis, Israel has been created as the place for the gathering of Jewish refugees, safe haven for Jewish people who were persecuted and slaughtered in Europe. But they ultimately, what ends up happening, those victims of the genocide in Europe, the major genocide in Europe of World War II, has now become involved in mass atrocities against the people who were living in Palestine. And so we are the Palestinians, as Edward Said said once, we are the victims of the victims. And that is very difficult time, because for many Israelis, and I listen to Jewish Israeli press or Hebrew press, and it is also a traumatic event for them, October 7th, because there were civilians who were targeted and attacked that were not combatants, and there were serious violations of human rights and international humanitarian law, and that has to be recognized and had to be investigated fully, including, by the way, any allegations of sexual crimes that committed during that day, which need to be taken seriously. But that's why I think we need to look forward into, okay, how do you get out of the situation? And the memory of the Nakba and what we will be commemorating this week has to be coupled with the commitment to ending the genocide first, mm-hmm. ending the denial of the Nakba of 1948, because mm-hmm. many people in Israel say, including the official Israeli government position, there is no such a Nakba. There is no such thing. It was your fault. You left the country. It's your leadership who called on you to leave the country. All kind of propaganda that really doesn't hold water, is not supported by historical facts. And more importantly, there's a need to have the ability to search for truth mm-hmm. and reconciliation, but with accountability. Here's where I wanted to say a couple of words about the International Criminal Court, because the International Criminal Court, which was set up since 2002, under the 1998 Rome Statute or Agreement, was intended to end impunity for the worst crimes of genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes. Later on, it was added the crime of aggression. And that court had been a revolutionary in the sense of turning point in the history of humankind, that for the first time since the Nuremberg trials, which were one-sided in the sense that they were only directed against the Nazi criminals, but did not really address other crimes, for example, a crime of dropping atomic bomb on Nagasaki and Hiroshima that has never been investigated as a crime against humanity. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so that International Criminal Court was set up in order to exactly deter and investigate the worst crimes, including genocide. And Palestine got a very important status at the United Nations, which was observer non-member state status, allowed it to join international organizations, including signing and ratifying treaties, which it mm-hmm. did, and it is now part of the ICC. And Israel, by committing crimes in territories that are defined under the Palestine as a state, even though there is no real the same kind of institutions that and ability for state to take on, but at least at the level of UN recognition and international recognition, it had opened a number of investigations before October 7, before the genocide was unfolding. But right now, the eyes are on the ICC and the criminal prosecutor, general prosecutor of the ICC, whether he would really take the right step of issuing arrest warrants against Israeli officials, Israeli leaders, and military commanders who were involved in instituting and committing the crimes and atrocities that we've seen. We don't know what the scope of that, what the basis of the arrest warrant, but there were some reports that this is very imminent. And mm-hmm. Israel's position was, if that happens, we are going to punish the Palestinian Authority that has led the demand for accountability at the ICC. In fact, there's a chorus of politicians in the United States that are calling to punish Palestinians and the Palestinian Authority that is for such actions. Biden administration is opposing any action by the ICC, because that is what the United States has been doing to protect Israel from such accountability actions. That would be a test. That would be an important test, because it's added to the ICJ move in mm-hmm. pushing for end to the atrocities and the genocide that was led by South Africa and other countries. Now it's the ICC, and its credibility is on the line. And we are mm-hmm. we cannot allow this institution, that as imperfect as it is, to mm-hmm. be bombarded by politicians that really are not committed to human rights, or are committed only to certain human rights or to certain people's human rights, but not to universal human rights, and particularly to protect people, including civilians. Now, the ICC, by the way, will be investigating both Israel and Hamas and other armed groups in Gaza. It's not mm-hmm. one-sided in that sense, right? And in fact, I read reports and statements by Hamas saying that they are accepting and they want inviting the UN and the International Criminal Court to investigate. It is Israel and the United States that are opposing that. And we wonder, why is that? Why Israel and the United States would prevent impartial, independent investigation into crimes.
I think that's the issue. They don't want impartial, independent, international scrutiny and eyes on this situation. So we're going to need to actually keep our eyes on this situation. I want to bring it on home for a moment, if that's okay. We have about 5 more minutes. You also teach as an adjunct professor at NYU. You've been involved in providing support to students who have been protesting. What do you think is happening on college campuses right now in terms of how universities are handling the protests? I know right here in D.C., at GW, the mayor initiated a hostile shutdown of GWU's encampment, pre-dawn 4 a.m. raid by hundreds of police, 33 students arrested as they were peacefully sleeping. And this is a scenario that is being played out across the country. So yeah, give us your sense with respect to all that.
Well, I think it is outrageous what's been happening in terms of the university and college's response to the peaceful protest. We have not seen this barbarity and violence in the crackdown on the organizers and student activism. And I think the reason for that goes back to a couple of things. One is, this is an issue that is not only about expressing opinion related to a very important human rights or atrocities happening outside the United States or outside the halls and the walls of the universities and campuses, right? It is an issue where the student movement has decided not only to raise awareness and solidarity in support of the Gaza people in Gaza against the genocide that's unfolding, but it has decided to hold their own institutions accountable. And so what that means, the action is directed towards the very institutions that is calling in the police, the very institutions that is being asked to disclose information about their financial ties to the Israeli military or any industry that is supporting the Israeli military offensive attacks and genocide, to divest from those institutions. We know that universities have very strong ties, many of them, including Ivy League universities such as Columbia and NYU, that have not only established ties, but also established chapters and campuses inside Israel. When we know that in Gaza, not a single academic institution was spared from the destruction. All of the 10 academic universities and academic institutions have been destroyed. There's none. Not to mention the widespread attacks on schools. Many of them are UN-run schools, or the UNRWA schools that are been created to serve the Palestinian refugees in Gaza. They've been systematically attacked. Scholars, up to over 100 academics, Palestinian academic professors have been killed. So the whole educational sector in Gaza has been completely destroyed. And there's no hope how long it will take, probably months and years, according to the UN, for people to be able to have some sort of basic education setting or forum. So what we're talking about is that while this is happening, universities in the United States are acting business as usual as far as their relationship with the same country and army that has been committing those crimes that are well documented and will continue to be investigated and documented. Mm-hmm. So what they needed to do is to listen to what the students have been asking, mm-hmm. sit down with them, try to understand what the things that they can do and respond to their demands, which are legitimate demand. It's not the first time that universities do that. They did that, and you've been involved in the South African divestment movement, and we know that universities did that in other contexts. We know that universities divested from fossil fuel, divested from areas that are less direct attack on humanity and on the lives of people, children and women and men that are nothing to do with the actual fighting. Lives are destroyed. So that was led to the university. Instead of doing that, they have listened to outside voices and including politicians, including congressional investigation that was investigating anti-Semitism in academic institutions and schools, where university presidents, instead of defending academic freedom and free speech on college campuses, they went and provided the answers that we can do more. And they went back, in fact, in the case of the president of Colombia, this is when she came back, President Minouche Shafiq, and called in the NYPD. And others did the same thing. So there are other outside organizations, including the ADL, that called on investigating the student activists as foreign agents, as Iranian foreign agents, as Hamas supporters, even though there was no link. There's no evidence whatsoever was provided. It was mere incitement to shut down important, legitimate, very powerful movement that, by the way, includes not only Palestinians and Arab and Muslim students, but more importantly, it is very diverse. It has Jewish students, Black and brown and indigenous students, and white students, and all shoulder to shoulder are resisting. Yes. So what I see at NYU, the same heavy-handed response, calling in the NYPD, calling in their militarized police to shut down peaceful encampment and to punish students by by leveling against students very harsh punishments. Of some of them were fired, some of them were dismissed from school, some of them got other kinds of disciplinary charges, which the students' movement is saying they have to be dropped. They have to be amnesty for those things. So I think what we are seeing, instead of de-escalating, the universities have the obligation. I want to end with that. It have the obligation to provide safe environment and equal access to education, and fight harassment, individual harassment and discrimination against individuals. And that needs to happen, even if there are anti-Semitic attacks on individuals that are attacked because they're Jewish students, need to be examined. But that is not what is happening. What I've seen is that there is a collective effort and collective organizing that is peaceful and that is legitimate. And that is not anti-Semitic. Criticizing Israel, calling for Israel to end the occupation is not anti-Semitic and should not be seen as such. And I think that's where I think we need to wake up and support the student movement and listen to what they have to say.
Yes, I agree 100%. I'm going to have you back on again, because I want you to talk, when you come back on again, about what your hopes are for the future of the Palestinian people. Are you optimistic that we will see a just political solution that will end Israel's apartheid genocidal regime and settler colonial occupation, guarantee dignity, safety, and quality for all? We're going to have you back to discuss that. We have been talking with Jamil Dakwar, who is a human rights attorney, adjunct professor at NYU, and director of the American Civil Liberties Union Human Rights Program. He is speaking in his individual capacity. Thank you so very much, Jamil.
Thank you so much for having me. All the best. All right.
Before I close my special show aired on this Nakba Day, produced internationally by Radio Free Palestine with participation from community and progressive radio stations and producers across 5 continents, I'd like to share a piece I recently wrote entitled "Current College Campus Protests for Justice and the Need for Reparations in the United States." Today's wave of protests and encampments on college campuses across the United States against Israel's military devastations in Gaza is sparking a renewed conversation about the intersectionality of social justice movements in general and the need for reparations for Black people in the United States. As students across campuses raise their fists and voices in solidarity with Palestinians facing repression, we must recognize and uplift the interconnectedness of struggles for justice and liberation at home and abroad. In recent weeks, college campuses have become hotbeds of activism and protest, with students mobilizing in solidarity with Palestinians amidst the escalating violence and oppression in Gaza, which also includes Jewish voices advocating for peace, justice, and human rights for all parties involved. Simultaneously, discussions about reparations for Black people, long overdue in the national discourse, have gained momentum, fueled by a growing recognition of historical injustices and systemic racism. The nexus between these two critical issues highlights the parallels between the struggle for Palestinian rights and the fight for reparations for Black people in the United States. The protests on college campuses against Israel's actions in Gaza stem from a deep-seated concern for human rights and social justice. As the world witnesses the devastating impact of violence and displacement of Palestinian communities, students are standing in solidarity with the oppressed, demanding an end to the occupation and blockage of Gaza. These protests must not be isolated incidents, but part of broader movements that challenge injustice and call for accountability. The quest for reparations for Black people in the United States is rooted in centuries of enslavement, Jim Crow apartheid, and systemic discrimination. The lingering impacts of enslavement continue to shape the current socioeconomic landscape, with Black communities disproportionately affected by poverty, violence, and lack of access to opportunities. Efforts to address this legacy through reparations have been met with backlash and resistance, but momentum is building as more people recognize the need for acknowledgement, restitution, and repair. The struggle for Palestinian rights and the fight for Black liberation are inherently connected by shared experiences of oppression and resistance. Both peoples have endured centuries of discrimination, dispossession, and violence, yet they have also demonstrated resistance, resilience, and a commitment to justice. By recognizing these shared experiences and building solidarity between movements, activists can amplify voices and strengthen impact. College campuses play a crucial role in shaping public discourse and driving social change. Indeed, students have historically been at the forefront of movements for justice, using their voices and platforms to advocate for meaningful reform. Today's campus demonstrations are reminiscent of past movements such as the anti-apartheid protests that shook South Africa and the world over 30 years ago, boycotting and advocating for divestment and sanctions in the face of arrest and backlash. The issue of reparations reemerges today as a crucial component of justice and reconciliation. Recognizing historical and current injustices are imperative in fostering healing and repair. Indeed, reparations is a vehicle for transformative change, and arguably is the only policy that comprehensively addresses the very crux of institutional and structural racism and inequity, the harms from government and related policies of the enslavement era that still manifest today in nearly every area of life, from health, wealth, and educational inequities to cultural deprivations and mass incarceration. We must recognize that the protests on college campuses nationwide against Israel's actions in Gaza and the demand for reparations for Black people in the United States are not isolated events. They are interconnected struggles, highlighting the need for solidarity and collective action. By recognizing the intersectionality of social justice movements, voting, climate, reproductive, LGBTQ, mass incarceration, and abolition, to name a few, we can build a more inclusive and equitable world for all. Now, more than ever, the need to educate and mobilize around reparatory justice is paramount. And by connecting historical struggles to contemporary injustices, we can build momentum as we strive for transformative change across all issue areas. Again, this is Nkechi Taifa, and I would like to thank human rights lawyer Jamil Dakwar for being my featured guest earlier today. Radio Free Palestine continues after this break. Stay tuned.